Welcome to the Homes and Construction Show. And in today's episode, we are going to look at solar energy. You may be out there and maybe you've had very many questions about solar, how you can acquire solar, which kind of house needs to have it installed. Worry no more, because today we have an expert and is going to guide us on what you have to know or what you've been asking.
See, solar energy is the energy which is earned from the sunlight for the purposes of lighting and also heating. So basically, we look at it in two portions, whereby when we look at harnessing electricity, that one is through the use of photovoltaics. These are the solar panels, as everybody knows them. And then when it comes to heating, also there are other equipments which are used to capture that heat and use it effectively. But I believe our show today is basically basing on solar electricity. How we can generate electricity from solar.
That is very true. And actually, we also need to know what kind of homes or buildings that are suitable to have solar panels on them.
Solar energy and use of it cuts across from the smallest home to a factory. What is happening is that the whole history of solar is that it has taken care of all those categories, because the solar panels, or rather the solar modules, are scalable. So it depends on your scale. If you're going to have a factory, then you go big scale. So there's also something for the big scale and something for the person who is deep in the village, especially the person who is looking at having even a single light for the family, or to do their homework, or to have some light move around the compound. So generally speaking, it cuts across from homesteads up to the factories. There's no limitation.
Does that mean that we have different types of solar energy?
Yes, we have different types of solar energies, which are basically categorized because by the technology they use. The basic technologies and where it started was the silicon, which was the basic, whereby silicon would be painted on glass and then subdivided into cells. Then from there, we went to more efficient polycrystalline, and then later we went to the monocrystalline, which is the high end of the solar panels. Although the mark between polycrystalline and the monocrystalline is very gray, it depends on where you're using them. Because in the area where we lie, which is around the equator, we have enough sunshine. So we don't have to go for the high end, which is more sensitive to very little light. We have enough sunshine, so we can be able to use the polycrystalline very effectively. Unlike the amorphous, the efficiency levels are so low, and people are trying to shy away from the amorphous, which is a very crude technology. So those are the three types of solar panels we have, in terms of which are classified based on the technology they use.
So does that mean that the classification depends on the location, or maybe the geographical location? Because you mentioned about in the equator region.
Yes. The classification is usually done by technology. Technology is the way the technology evolves, is that is what classified them. This is where we started from amorphous, which was less efficient.
Amorphous was the first one. That's what you said, that we used kind of like silicon.
Yes, whereby you have a silicon and you paint it on glass and you divide it into cells, join the cells, and then you generate electricity. The efficiency for those solar modules was between 4 to 6%, which was very low.
And then four to six percent of what?
Of what we always look at, if we go to the more technical terms, we look at the amount of sunshine which falls within a square meter and how much you generate from there. it's more technical, but basically that is the gauging of the efficiency of the solar panel. With 1 square meter, with this amount of light falling on it, how much does it generate?
So the first one, the amorphous,
yes,
we used to get
four to six percent.
6%.
The maximum which was attained, although many other technologies after that came, the triple junction, the double junction, but we could not be able to reach the efficiencies of the polycrystalline, which came later, and then the monocrystalline. Also on the other technologies, also the cost of production and what you're getting out of it could not be able to match in terms of the economies of scale. So most of the manufacturers also shifted to the more efficient solar panels, which are the polycrystalline and the monocrystalline.
Mm.
So basically it's like the amorphous. It's like, you see these days, nobody drives a carburetor car.
Mm.
Because more efficient cars have come, which are using electronic injection and all that. So basically technology has shifted people to more efficient solar modules, which are being produced en masse.
So the
polycrystalline and the monocrystalline.
Polycrystalline and monocrystalline,
yes,
right?
Yes.
How much energy does it generate in percentage?
Basically, the efficiencies for poly and mono, they range between 15 and 25%.
Mm.
Okay, depending on the manufacturers. The reason why I'm saying depending on the manufacturers is that you find that even solar modules are classified. You find that it's class A, it's class B, it's class D.
Mm.
So if you're looking at class A, you're looking at basically a very good solar module with very high production and also very durable.
Mm.
So basically you find that, yes, with that kind of efficiency, then you can be able to produce more within, like I said, within that, what they use worldwide, within 1 meter square. And the technologies are always changing. With the new technologies now, they're looking at having high efficiencies whereby you have the cooling of the cells. Because what happens with the cells is that once they are hit by very strong sunshine, as much as they try to produce more, but they also heat up and the efficiency reduces. So more research is being done into ways of cooling the cells so that they can be contained in that 25 degrees, whereby that is the temperature at which they can be able to produce optimally.
Mm.
But this is something which is evolving. Research is always evolving. So there's a lot which is going in the solar industry, and I'm sure in the next years to come, we'll see modules of very high efficiencies based on what is happening.
So what determines the efficiency?
The efficiency is basically depends on the refinement of the cells during the manufacturing. It depends also on the purity of, if you go deep into the design, what they call the doping. I'm sure most of the viewers would not want to go into that technology of how the solar panels are made. But basically, those are the issues which determine the efficiency of the modules.
Mm.
The kind of elements which you combine, at what ratios you combine them, that all that put into perspective is what determines the efficiency of a solar modules during production.
You mentioned that we can use solar from like domestic use to industrial use.
Exactly,
right?
Exactly.
So I would like to know, even I believe our viewers really need to know, what or how much or how many panels would I need, for instance, if I have a factory or if I have a home of, let me say, like 10 people living in it.
Okay, thank you very much. What we look at is that the starting point of installing a good solar system does not start with your pockets.
Mm.
It starts with your requirements, which you always call the user requirements. So the first thing we do is to collect your requirements. What do you want to do with this solar system?
Mm.
What loads do you have? Just to give you an example, you say that I have a home, it's a 3-bedroom house. I want to have a TV, I want to have a washing machine, I want to have my 75-inch TV. And then you come and say, okay, fine, these are the loads you have. how long are you going to use the TV, the security lights, and the lights inside the house?
Oh, does that really matter?
Exactly. Because solar is, I always say that solar is like a bank account, which has no overdraft.
Yeah.
You cannot be able to withdraw what you have not deposited. Okay? So the first thing is you collect enough energy which can be able to run your equipment. Because if you look at the solar, is made up of three components. We have the solar panel, we have the charge controller, and we have the batteries. Okay? So if I can go back to those three components, is that the solar panel is what generates the electricity. And this electricity goes through the charge controller. The charge controller is like the central manager of the system. It controls the charging of the batteries, and it controls how much you're giving to your load. Okay? And then down here, the battery, like you can see here, these are two forms of storage, different technologies. Once you collect that energy, because the sunshine is always up during the day, you need to store it somewhere so that you can be able to use it in the evening. Okay? Because as soon as 6 o'clock, the sun goes down, but you want to run your TV, you want to run your lights, basically you want to power your equipment. So you need to have a storage place for you, for the energy you've collected the day. And then at night, that is the time now you go to what you have saved.
Mr. Bore, you're actually taking me far, and I'm kind of skipping something, let me say, very important.
Yes.
Because before reaching that point,
yes,
you mentioned that the consumption at home is what drives.
Exactly.
Now, tentatively, if I'm looking at someone in Tungamo.
Yes.
Of course, they're not going to have a fridge, they're not going to have perhaps that 45-inch screen. So they'll only need power.
Yes.
For lighting, charging, and okay, maybe really a TV, which cannot even be that huge.
Okay.
So if you're starting with that, what determines the solar, let me say, solar panel or solar energy, or the amount of amps that I should have?
Okay.
On that house of my, maybe my mother.
Let me take you through the we call it the sizing system. What we'll do is that we'll ask you, you come and say you have a home in Tungamo, it's a three-bedroom house, you want to have a TV and a charging system. So we ask you, how big is the TV? Tell us it's either that 2-inch or 45-inch. Based on, from the technical side, I know that probably a 45-inch TV consumes this amount of energy. There's always a nameplate which you read from on the back of the TV. So you can be able to, it's always there. It's always written in amps or watts or VA. So you know that this TV consumes 20 watts. And then I ask you, how long is your mother going to be watching the TV? You say from 7 to 11. Those are 4 hours. So we know that 20 times 4, so that is 80 watt hours. So you put that on the side. Okay? We look at the lights. How many lights are there in this house? There are four of them. So let's talk about, maybe if you're going to use 7 watts. And for how many hours?
Like 5.
5 hours. So it is 7 times 4 times 5. There, we get the energy which will be required for that period of time. We add on what you got from the TV. So we look at the security lights. How many security lights? 4 security lights, and they're going to run 12 hours. How many hours? 5 hours. We calculate that in watt hours and add. Okay? Then at the bottom, we know that this is the amount of energy which you need to collect per day in order to run those equipment, the lights, the TV,
the charging
for effective. This, yes, for this period of time. And then from there we go to our stock. Okay, we see what we have is that we, because solar panels, they come in different sizes, come from the smallest up to the, yes, it's not one size which fits all. you'll have solar panels, you can even have 2.5 watt. Up to now, you can get even 545 watts. So you have a whole range.
The bigger the size, the bigger the watts. Is that what you want to say?
Yes, depending on the technology. Because if you look at this, like this one is a 325 watts. Mm. But if you look at the old technology of Amorphous, this one would be more or less like 100 or less than 100 watts. Big, but old technology. As the technology grows, you get big sizes. Mm. You get small sizes with big wattages. So what I'm trying to say is that so we look at out of this range which you have or what you have installed, probably we have 5, 10, we have 90, 100, 120, 150, up to, we say, okay, fine. Based on what you have calculated, how many solar panels either of 120 watts will we use here? We do our calculations. What size of charge controller will those solar panels need? We do the calculations. What storage will we need? We do the calculation.
So by storage, what do you mean?
Storage is that the amount of energy you're going to collect from the solar panels, you need to store it because you're not using it as you collect it.
You use it directly.
Directly, yes.
We collect it during the day.
Keep it.
Use it at night.
Use it at night. So we use the batteries for storage. So these are the type of batteries you can use for storage. We have various sizes like you've seen in our office here. We have from the smallest up to the biggest. Mm. So from there, we know that this is a solar panel. These are the number of solar panels you need. This is the size. This is the size of the charge controller. And this is the size of the battery you need. Okay?
Wait a minute. You mentioned that the number of solar panels that I may need.
Yes.
So it means that we can't have one solar panel which can accommodate... let me say like 1,000 watts.
No, we have not reached that level where we have one solar panel which is 1,000 watts.
So the largest?
The largest at the moment should be around 545 watts. Mm. But what's in solar, the good thing with solar systems is that they are scalable. Okay? Mm. So you can say that, like, let's say your mother begins to say that what she needs at home now to run all this, let's say, is 108 watts. At a given time, she wants to have a small fridge, okay?
So in the village?
In the village, yes.
To put milk?
Yes, to put milk and to preserve other things she gets from the supermarket. So we say, okay, fine, you don't have to throw your old system, okay? What we are going to do is that you're going to get another 108 watt solar panels and then we combine. So now you have 360 watts. The only thing which is going to change here now, because now the amount of energy you're collecting now has increased. So we need to change the charge controller because the charge controller which you had put there was only to accommodate the 108 watts. Mm. Now we have gone to 360. And then you realize that you need more storage because now you're collecting more. So you increase on the storage.
By increasing on the storage, you may have to get another battery.
Yes, which is slightly bigger. But having said that, that is at the village level. Mm. Because like I said, solar you can use, it's use is quite broad. For somebody who has an office like here, like here we use solar. Absolutely. So up there we have solar panels. Mm. Down there you can see we have our system there.
What is that system?
That is called an hybrid inverter, or rather an hybrid system, and that is where I was going to for small offices. Mm. Having said that, is that you can start small because there are some systems which don't even need storage because, like here in office, we are here during the day.
Okay, what kind of systems are those that really don't need storage?
Yes, these systems are the offices, like where we are now.
You consume the way you...
Yes, as you generate, you consume. Because if you look at a solar system, the most expensive component in a solar system is a battery. Hmm. The prices of solar panels has always been going down, but the prices of batteries have never gone down. Because the potent component in making the battery is the lead, and the lead prices have never gone down.
Oh,
but silicon is a is one of the major components in making solar panels. Silicon is always available everywhere.
Mm.
You just need to refine it. But lead is not as readily available as silicon.
Mm.
So what happens is that if you have a small office, you can start small. What you need to have, you need to have your hybrid inverter. And then you can say that for the first 1 month, I'm going to start with two panels based on the load which you have calculated. And they say by 3 months or 4 months, I want to have achieved this. So you can go on adding your solar panels until you achieve your desired
consumption.
Exactly. So those are the systems which are used for offices. And now for offices, you can say that, okay, fine. Since we are not 100% sure that we are going to work from 8 to 6, we also want to have some small storage. So there you don't have to have storage which is going to be able to run all the equipment in your office. You can have a small storage probably for the lights when you're in the office.
Mm.
Maybe if you go past 6, and that's it. Then there are other systems which are called grid tie.
Grid tie,
these are the systems which are being used by industries or relatively bigger scale offices, whereby this one works hand in hand with electricity, doesn't use any storage, it works with electricity. So you have your solar panels, you have your grid tie inverter, feeding the solar panels, feeding umeme, and then the load. So they'll be seeing each other. If the sun goes down, umeme kicks in.
Wait a minute. So what kind of... Okay, at what point in installation will, like, an expert have that system installed? At what point? Because this is what I'm looking at. I don't want to waste energy. I don't want to waste my power.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want the two of them to be running at the same point, if actually that can even happen.
That one will not happen. Like I said, the starting point of a good solar system, it starts with eliciting the user requirements.
Mm.
If it is a factory, how much energy do you need in a day? There's so many ways of doing that, because you cannot just walk into a factory and say that, okay, from the machines I've seen, you're going to need this.
Recharge controller.
The charge controller.
So what is this?
Now, this one tells you what is happening.
But it's charging, right? It's battery.
Yes.
So it means it is receiving.
It is receiving.
Mm.
And this is the storage.
Where is this one?
This is the storage. Yeah, this is basically an inverter charger. They're basically used for backup systems. But with this one, it doesn't integrate a solar system, or rather it doesn't integrate solar panels. This is what integrates the solar, and this is what you use in the office.
So I'm seeing how it is connected. So
yes.
The other one connects here.
We have,
and then we have this that is
going to the battery.
Storage.
Yes, that is the storage. Yes.
And then what are the switches for?
This one comes from the solar panels.
Mm.
We have 10 of them, 325 watts, so we have 3.25 kilowatts.
Mm.
This is what comes, you see it is being terminated in this box.
Mm.
Okay. And then this is umeme.
Mm.
Okay. Mm. We use both. Like you can see here, as soon as the sun, you see?
Yeah.
So we are basically using the solar panels.
From, which color does it have?
No, this one will go off. Like when the sun is bright, the umeme will go off and will go back to solar.
Mm.
So basically, like on a sunny day, we rarely touch umeme.
Mm.
No, and umeme we leave it there as an emergency.
Mm.
And at the same time, we're also charging our batteries. So it tries to optimize what it's getting.
You have heard it all. the solar system is more like a banking system. You cannot withdraw what you have not deposited. And in this case, our only deposit is on sunshine or sunlight. So we are going to stop here for today, but in our next episode, we are going to look at the do's and the don'ts of solar. We are going to look at the cost implication, the applicability, and the maintenance. So do not even think of being in somewhere else or not having this conversation continued. My name is Hilda Kamkama, and this is the Homes and Construction Show. Until next time, may God bless you.